Welcome to Broadcast, an initiative by the Composer Society of Singapore. Broadcast is an online interview series featuring conversations with Singapore composers, produced by CSS student members To Yan Yi and Rebecca Tan. Join us as we invite CSS member composers to share with us their musical journey, compositional processes and inspirations, as well as their perspectives on music. Hi, I'm Yan Yi. And in this first episode of Broadcast, we have none other than Dr. Robert Casteels, a composer, researcher, conductor, pianist, and educator who has made significant contributions to Singapore's music scene. Born in Belgium, Dr. Casteels studied piano performance and orchestral conducting and continued his musical endeavors in Europe and America before coming to Singapore in 1994. While Dr. Casteels had already started composing as a performer and educator, it was not only until he settled down in Singapore that his compositional career really took flight. Join me in this episode as I meet with Dr. Casteels to talk about his recent projects, musical inspirations, and thoughts on the Singapore music scene. So first of all, thank you, Dr. Casteels, for being so willing to come on board this interview series. So my first question for you, Dr. Casteels, is definitely, how did you start composing? Was there a definitive point in your life where you decided that you wanted to compose? And was it always something that you were aspiring towards?
I wasn't very keen. And then at the time I had a friend who was a violinist and she needed an encore piece. So I said, okay, I'll write. So at the end of her recital, she played the encore piece. Applauding. Oh, and then they ask her who is the composer. So okay, then after that I started to write. Then I finished my studies and I start to have work as a conductor, and I stopped composing for two reasons. It's just so much pressure as a young conductor to study all your scores and all that. Two, I hear so much new music that I cannot have time to isolate myself mentally. So then I think for, I don't know, 10, 15 years, I did not write anything. And then I came to Singapore, and in Singapore, suddenly I started to compose one piece. And then I didn't stop. And now I conduct less and less, and I compose more and more. Now I'm really not interested anymore to conduct another concert with established repertoire. There are not two journeys that are the same. So young people as a teenager in MEP program already have an urge to compose, I think is fantastic. I'm absolutely not looking down on these people thinking they are naive, or who the hell they think they are. Not at all. It's just everybody has a different journey. Even in 1994, when I arrived here, it's not that you are in the middle of nowhere. That's not true. But you are also not surrounded by so much new music as in Europe. I read this once in a letter that Haydn wrote. Haydn was not living in Vienna. He was employed by this prince outside, 30, 40 kilometers outside of Vienna, which at that time was like in Patu Pahatma. And so he wrote that he needed something like, I forgot the exact words, he needed some isolation to create. And I entirely agree with that. If I would be living in New York or in London or Paris or Berlin, I don't think I would be composing. Or maybe now, if today I move, maybe. But younger, I would be so all the time hear so much, and then I have to go and listen this, and then it's so and so, and then this famous one, and then this, and this ensemble. I think I would have no mental space to find my own, just to find my own journey. Here in Singapore, there was very little. And then there was something else. Here in Singapore, I discovered non-European music. So I started to study Indian music and gamelan and Chinese music, not to play the instruments. But so this I find, I'm intellectually a very curious person. I want to read all sorts of things. I wasn't exposed to in Europe. In Europe, it was really white music. And then I arrive here and then I find it very interesting. And then also the non-well-tempered tuning systems, that really interested me. And then I started to become computer literate, which I wasn't before. I think it's a combination of being in a completely new environment, being relatively isolated, but not completely, and new music that I could discover that could fuel my intellectual interest and curiosity and research. And then all these things together. Plus, I was Dean of Music at La Salle College, and La Salle has a very good gamelan orchestra, as Sundanese, as Balinese, as Javanese, and these instruments, they were there. And under the first founder president of La Salle called Brother McNally, Joe McNally, he wanted the academics to have a professional practice. So everything is there at the right time together. And there wasn't, I think the pressure on us, administrative pressure and teaching pressure, was lesser than now. Life was a bit slower. And so that means I had time, I could make time, and so that's how I started to compose again.
Yeah, interesting. So Dr. Casteels, with that, I'd like to ask you about what are your thoughts on new music in relation to the music scene in Singapore. And the new music scene in Singapore has been growing, as always. It's very encouraging to see this continuous growth. But I want to know, what are your views on the impact of contemporary music and contemporary art in Singapore? And what has your experience been with the public perception of contemporary music over the years?
There has always been contemporary music. And then I discount the view of certain academics to say that if in 2020 you write music like in the style of Mozart, you are writing contemporary music because it's done in the time. So that let's discount that. But there has always been contemporary music, and there should always be contemporary music. If in a society there is no new art, then that society is sick or is dying. And if there is no consumption and practice of art in the young generation, that's an art form that in two generations will die, obviously, because the old ones are disappearing gradually. Okay, so I don't think in general in the world the state of contemporary music is catastrophic nowadays, or that it was much better before. When you read really in details the lives of Baroque composer, classical composer, Romanticism is just one horror story after the other. So it's not that before everybody was listening and knew and there was appreciation and now there isn't. That is not true. As you know, there are composers who are very famous and loved during their lifetime and then disappear afterwards. Who knows Telemann, the music by Telemann? Who knows J.S. Bach? And at their time, it was the contrary. Telemann was the big star. Nobody knew J.S. Bach. So I would lie if I say that I don't care if people like my music or not. That's not true. We all want to be loved. But whether I'm very famous, a bit famous, less famous, it that really doesn't bother me. Whether how much of my music is going to survive after I have joined my ancestors, I don't know. I do hope something will survive. I'm comfortable in Singapore because I don't have problems with censorship and self-censorship. That's a little thing I found disconcerting with the younger generations, is their amount of self-censorship. So, of course, I'm white. I cannot hide. I'm white. I have roots, and I think it's good to have roots. But I'm, as much I am integrated, I'm not born here. So I'm also trying not to be more local than the locals, which is a typical phenomenon for immigrants. So I feel rather free in Singapore because A, I'm lucky with music. Music is unlike written word. Even if I want to say something socially critical, I can always hide behind the sounds. It's not as confrontational as the word, the written and spoken word. B, in Europe, you are very categorized. You are a composer who's like the Boulez school. And then another one is the Anglo-Saxon, and the other one is Wolfgang Riem, and the other one is the Italian Maderno, Berio, and all that. Here, by lack of knowledge and by lack of contemporary musical culture, nobody cares. And I have written pieces in very different styles, and so I feel very free. Then three, this is a young country that has energy, and compared to West European democracies, it's not bad the amount of money that exists here to support the arts. In a European country, you have many more people who have to fight for a proportionally smaller pie. Then, honestly, I do not have here the same level. The performances here are not of the same level as in Europe. You don't have a Singapore ensemble like Ensemble Moderne or Sinfonietta. So over time, I've changed a bit my composition style. I have become less complex, maybe, which is not bad. And I have gone to using computers. So I have done, and it's not, I don't view it as, I'm in the middle of the Sahara. No point to try to sell swimming pools in the middle of the Sahara. As a composer, you also respond to your environment. At the same time, you have to have be mentally free and independent. You have to be able to push away a bit to create a space in which you can breathe and think. But at the same time, you cannot function and live in isolation. So far, I've only written one opera, and it was for an organization in Belgium, my country of birth. If I would have lived and grown up and lived and functioned in Germany, I'm sure I would have composed more operas. But in Singapore, how and where am I going to have? So that's just life. On the other hand, if I would have continued to live in Belgium, I don't think I would have done as much with computers and electroacoustic I've done here.
Thank you for sharing your experiences. Am I right to say that if you hadn't come to Singapore, you wouldn't have continued composing or wouldn't have been composing with medium and instruments like traditional instruments, specifically in the Southeast Asian region?
Yes, it would have been different if I would have lived. I don't know better or worse, but it would have been different for sure. And for sure, I would not have done all that stuff with gamelan I didn't do fusion music because it would be fashionable I was doing quite a bit of it, not understanding why more of my colleagues were doing that as well. My Singaporean-born composer colleagues, they sort of admire European music. It's not that I don't admire European music, but I have no chip on my shoulder because it's normal, I'm born in that. So I was like intrigued by non-European music. So for me, it made totally sense to add non-European instruments, not to be special or to, but just because it fills gaps. To give a simple example, Chinese music is very rich in plucked strings. European music is poor in plucked strings. After the harpsichord, the harp and the guitar, that's it. So to me, I formed a group myself, and then it doesn't matter. I think I'd like to have a plucked instrument in that middle register. Okay, then I go and look what do the Chinese have? And then I take that one, not because it's Chinese, but because it's a plucked instrument that with technical specifications that correspond to, I would like to have a plucked instrument in that register. And same with the gamelan instruments. Of course, you have to solve the tuning issues. And so that's why I often had the comment of people who wondered, how come it's possible? It's just possible if you start from a scientific approach. This instrument, this is its range, this is what it can do, and this is what I would like in that piece. So I just go off the shelf, I take that instrument. And I don't at all have a sociological approach. And time again, now not so much, I had to defend myself. I respond to criticism because I'm white of neo-colonialism, which is worse than outright colonialism. They were really going out to colonize and civilize other parts of the world, and then I'm actually coming to steal gamelan and steal an Indian instrument and steal and that, and I all the time I say no, I'm not writing gamelan music, I'm not writing Chinese music. I want a who for its very special timbre, which the Western violin doesn't have. That's all. But that, I think that has calmed down. Nowadays, I think audience and reviewers, they have seen so much of this that it's not a big deal anymore. And they don't ask these questions anymore. And I don't encounter this kind of criticism anymore.
I'm glad to hear that this problem is not something that you would encounter nowadays, so it's nice. I think it's quite interesting, and I agree with your scientific perspective of choosing instruments because it's really all about the sonorities and the timbral quality of the instrument itself and what it can do for you and for your piece. I think in these times where a lot of sensitive issues on culture and race are being discussed and continuously debated on, it's nice that we are being more objective on our choices.
Yes, and so, but then, for instance, working with gamelan, I knew the the codes, I knew what was offensive for gamelan players. And I never went in that direction. There is a piece by Peter Maxwell Davis called Eight Songs for a Mad King, in which at one point the violinist destroys his violin, hits it on the floor and it destroys it. It's very shocking for me. It's like, that is like a red line. It's physically painful. And of course they have a trick. He has 20 bars rest and he takes another fake violin, and his nice violin, he hides it. So the audience thinks he's destroying the instrument he was just playing on. Of course not. But just the idea of destroying a musical instrument, I find it's like criminal. And so I would never do this, like ask a player to step over the gamelan instrument and then to go against the identity of an instrument that I never did. And then also, I find that contrary to what a lot of people think, they think that if you are not very good at, and then you do fusion anyhow. On the contrary, because if I rehearse a musician playing a Western instrument, I can tell him, do this with the boat or this and that. No, this mute and then, no, this stick and play with this part of the stick. When I work with musicians of another culture, I cannot give him such precise technical, so I have to trust him. So then I have to describe what kind of timbre, what kind of sound. That means I have to work with a very good musician so that he translates and he can hear and translates, then I do like this, or then we can do like this, and then. So you are doing with actually musicians who are very strong in their own culture. Because also they are not defensive. If you are very strong in your own culture, it's not that you view another culture as an aggression. It doesn't weak your own identity and your own practice because that one is solid. You are just curious and interested. And sometimes you find commonalities. But for that, you need to work with people who are solid, not, that doesn't mean intolerant, but who are just knowledgeable, solid in their own culture. Then they are curious, and then they can bridge my inability to tell him I don't speak Mandarin, to tell him exactly what he has to do on his gaohu, or what he has to do with his swona, or tell him this is not very practical, but if you put this note there, then it becomes, I say, okay.
Maybe now we move on to talk about one of your most recent projects, which is titled Rəsiliəncə. I think it's a really meaningful collaboration. So for those who may not be familiar with your project, could you give a short explanation on what this whole collaboration is about?
So, first, what is this project? It is a response to COVID, to the isolation in which we have been forced, in which like the reset button for a lot of things in our life, and it affected absolutely everybody. During the March to June period, I have not written a single note of music. And I was absolutely not depressed. It's not that I was destroyed. And it's not that I had no ideas. And it's not that so it's strange because I had an ocean of time, like never, yeah? And I was not using this time to compose. And then, because I also spend more time on the phone than on Skype and on than usual, I spoke with several composers in Singapore and in Europe, and I found that they were sort of all in the same situation. They suddenly had much more time and were not writing. Also because some projects were deferred, were postponed. So your sense of a deadline is also moved. Okay, so what I did was I composed a soundtrack using only MIDI sounds. Then I went to the studio and worked with Pavan studio, recording studio, and worked to have a better quality of sound than the default one of my Sibelius software. And in certain parts, not everywhere, I did electroacoustic transformations. And so I have a soundtrack of 19 minutes and 19 seconds. So the whole thing is on COVID, is actually very, very simple. I start in E major in the beginning, which is already strange for me. Usually I don't write in something major or minor. And in the beginning, everything is fine for a few minutes. And then I have, you know what is a foreign note to the key that starts to creep in, which is then, of course, a dissonance. And this, they start to, of course, I work it out mathematically so that they develop according to a certain pace. And then at one point, you have more foreign notes than key notes. Then I guess it starts to sound atonal, obviously. Yeah. And I go through four storms, each one more violent than the other. And it ends optimistically. By nature, I am an optimist person. Because I believe that humanity always finds the solutions just in time. And I've read about this. It's not that it was much better before. Actually, we have it better nowadays. And the problems, the world problems, plastic pollution, and you name it all, it is huge. But the advance of science is also amazing. Okay, so then I have this track. And then I have hired a small number of musicians. I think it's eight, including a dancer, a writer, and a filmmaker. And I gave them the piece and I said, choose a portion. For the filmmaker, he had to do the whole thing. And so then they had to work at home because that's the philosophy of we cannot rehearse all together. And then they communicate with me because studio time is expensive, as you know. Studio time is not to start the discussion. Shall I do this? What do you think of that? If they record at home, I have a lot of problems later, either to use different software, different quality, and then visually it's going to look mm-hmm. terrible. And I will have more work to have all this harmonized and clean. So we go to the studio one by one, COVID obliged, one by one. And then there is a whole work of editing. Now, fundamentally, there is something else that is much more interesting for me is control. And we spoke about that during one of the web chats. I'm educated as a conductor. So you get the score with all this information and you rehearse and you go as far as you can with other people's composition as the same as with mine, in approaching ideally what the composer had imagined thanks to the written information. So I'm very trained as a conductor to have a lot of control on the players. No, is this dynamic? No, is this tempo? And I'm not a jazz person in improvisation. I can listen to jazz, but it's not naturally my practice. So I have done For instance, in 2010, I did a piece called Holler Across the Holler, because holler in English has two meanings, as is a valley in V, and is also to shout, a shout. And it's because I had spent time in the mountains between Laos, Thailand, and China, and I've seen these people who half speak, half sing from one side of the valley to the other side, because acoustically is very possible. So I did a piano concerto without conductor. And where you have the conductor, you have the percussionist. And the players are also mixed, not the usual formation. And there is a sequence, there are no bars, no time signature. You play after so-and-so and before so-and-so. And then they ask me, can you conduct the rehearsal? I say, no, brother. So I have done a number of pieces where I gradually give freedom to the performers. And I have to control myself, even during this project Resilience, because naturally I want to say, no. Hey, can you do this? Can you talk? Then I just say no. if I tell you, you are free to do this, I have to respect my word and let all these people. I have conducted them in some previous project or whatever, and then they would always ask me, is this okay or can I do this? And then inside myself, I say, oh no, if you want to do that, oh no. And then I say, no, okay, go ahead. And then I say, But it turned out the result, I think, is very good. But it's also because I also choose people that I knew that I have inborn creativity. I didn't hire people who I know are fantastic players, but can only play what's written on the score. And so it is a bit angst, because I say, what are they trying to do? Da, 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 da. But maybe also with age, you learn to let go. You have to trust life. You have to trust people. It is consequent with the spirit, the concept of the project, which is we are all confronted with the same crisis. That is, all of them are confronted with the same soundtrack. And then we all react in our way to the crisis. They all react in their own way to the same music. But then we are not alone. And so out of this adversity, we create something, and we resilience will get through it.
So how was it like working with the filmmakers?
It was actually easy, because I have had some experience with filmmakers. I like visual arts. I really like contemporary visual arts, especially. I don't know why. When I go to an exhibition of contemporary art, I come out and I have a musical idea. If I go to an exhibition of Michelangelo and Leonardo da Vinci and Rubens, and you name all the painters, I also admire, also fantastic, but I don't come out with a musical idea at all. But when I go to a contemporary exhibition with contemporary painters and sculptors, of whom I don't know even any names, somehow, I don't know. Okay, so in 2016, this project called Hearing Images and Seeing Sound. So we did all kinds of things, and with the sound waves that are inside the sculpture, and then amplify that. And I did take one of the greatest pieces of Chinese visual arts is a hand scroll that dates from, I forgot which century, and called Nine Dragons. It's very famous. When you see it, you go, oh, yes, yes, yes. And then I composed a piece of music with nine parts and the dragons. And with the videographer, I asked her to film it, that it unfolds first without transformation and then starting to transform it exactly as. So there I had the image first. From the image was created the moving image, to which I responded with sound. And the transformation of the image and the composing was a bit parallel. In Rəsiliəncə is a totally different approach. I had composed, and as all composers here and there, I have sometimes I have an image. For me, this climate, since I love hiking in the mountains, and for me, this is after the whole day, you go up, and it's tough, tough, tough. And then suddenly you arrive at the summit and it's like, wow. But I have no, for somebody else, this, of course, another person will also hear is the climax, but will imagine something else visually. And Roberto the flautist had a very interesting comment that in music, his visual response internal is very often abstract. And I totally agree with this. Okay, so here, even though I compose my music, John, I give it to, like that, I give it to the filmmaker. I had seen a bit of his work, so I said, oh, I like that style. And I did not tell him anything like, at 2 minutes and 15 seconds, there is a modulation that you have to do. And there is the climax and is the circle, nothing. I just told him it's about resilience and it's about Singapore. And that's it. And so then, okay, we will see. That's part of my, I let go. And I decide I'm not going to. So he films, and then the first time he was very careful to show me 1 minute. Because I'm the artistic director of the project. If I explode, so it's the first time, so he's very careful. I said, "Why? No, I like it." He said, "Really?" I said, "Yes, yes. Keep going, and you don't show me every time you have another 30 seconds. Just do." And then when he did the whole thing, I was very careful. I said, maybe if you could consider on the 19 minutes, I think I had three spots where I suggested that image. I think it could go 2 seconds later, because that's where I have a chord or a modulation or something. And then he responded, oh yes, and all three, he changed, he adjusted, but slightly, you know. And for all the rest, not only wasn't I disturbed, shocked or angry, but I thought, he keeps saying, I don't know anything about music. I told him, you stop saying that. Yes, you don't know the technical vocabulary, because that's not your training and your craft. Neither do I know anything about how to film and how to edit, but your analysis is correct. What you do is really, really, there is nothing that disturbs or destroys the music. So there, I think I'm very lucky and very grateful.
Oh, I wanted to ask you something. I noticed that your entire soundtrack is 19 minutes and 19 seconds. Was this intentional? And did you actually consider writing 20 minutes and 20 seconds because 2020?
No. I've done quite a bit on music and mathematics. And I don't call it music and mathematics, but my third symphony of 2006 and another piece called Hanging Gardens in 2015. I like to assign myself rules, which contain me. I first have here and there an idea. And I don't know yet if this will be the beginning, the middle, or the end of the piece. It will be somewhere in the piece, okay? And I can have so two or three, and so far yet unconnected. And when they come, I'm happy that they come, and I do write them down. In short, just scribble, not yet computer, just scribble, okay. But then quickly, sooner than later, I want to have a structure. And this structure, I submit it to a very strict mathematical proportions. I want this to be exactly one third longer than this part and then to the second, yeah? And later to change this, it's really a soul searching decision. It's not that, okay, no. Yeah. So this is one bar too many. So where can I take one bar off so that it fits? And I don't like to speak too much about this in the program notes, nor to the general audience, because I find that then they think, oh yeah, surely it's very intelligent, but it's too cheap for me, I cannot appreciate. You better tell people that it's about pink clouds and about the birds that singing there, and then is this my childhood memory? Then telling them, oh, I use Fibonacci and I do palindromes and I did the ABBA, because then, and both are correct, but you better talk about the human side and not about the design, the mathematical, because then people have a biased perception. But I also have to be careful that it doesn't become an intellectual game at the expense of the quality of the sounds that are coming out of the composition. So here, COVID-19, well, it's clear everything is about 19. And then the lengths of periods, they are multiple of 19s. And so that's a decision I take very early in the process of composition, and I stick to it. That's what I find disconcerting with electroacoustic, is that the possibilities are endless. And so it's like, at one point, it's like I'm in the middle of the ocean, and what do I do here? Whereas if I decide on a structure, and it is 19 minutes, and so many periods, 19 of them, and then so many beats and so many seconds. So sometimes it's too short or too long, and so I have to adjust. And it's like I feel like saying, oh, it's okay, leave me alone. And then the other part of myself said, no, it has to fit.
So I suppose that mathematics plays a big part in your compositions, especially in structure. What do you think are the main themes or inspirations of your pieces over the years? Are there any recurring themes?
One that is recurrent is nature. I'm not an idealist ecologist. I used to fly, I have a handphone. My way of living also creates waste. And my first real piece about this was in 2003 called Spirit of Wood, for the Asia Civilization Museum, about wood carving. Then I did the same year, A Day in the Life of a Garden. So it's people who walk in botanic garden. And so I went to record cicadas and birds and the frogs before or after the rain. It's an extraordinary sound. And so I had a soundtrack with this natural sound, and then I had a percussionist and a pianist. Then I did two series of bird songs. In 2009 on bird calls that are threatened with species of birds that are threatened with extinction. And in 2015, a second series with birds that are all extinct in Singapore. because since 1949, there are records. And I'm a member of the Nature Society. So I go to these walks and I go to these lectures. And then I did a 2014 hydropyre on the Hays, and aqua ignis in 2016. So that was about forest fire. I did a zero carbon piece with actors who also sing, also recite, also play, which was played on the beach. Of course, it's not totally correct because they also we also rehearsed in a room that had aircon. Okay, but so nature, it's not something that I planned in the beginning, and it's not that I'm obsessed and every single piece that I churn out has to be about that. But that it's another theme that comes here and there through a number of pieces. I did on music and finance, the stock market. I did a string quartet in 2011 called Greed and Fear. The response of human beings functions on greed and fear. Greed because you want to invest and you want to get the highest return as possible, and fear because you're always afraid that you bought or sold at the wrong moment, and unless or lose. The financial world has this vocabulary that sounds very complicated, and you hear this analyst speaking and it's as if it's a church with a high priest and they talk about all this, and you listen to this. If you're not in this world, it sounds like a very complicated, and actually very often it's not as complicated and daunting as it looks. Okay, so it's for a string quartet with video. And the video shows a ticketing, how do you call this? A ticketing with the numbers, the symbol of the company. And then in red, if the value goes down, green, if it goes up, and it passes like this. And I also had a child read very complicated analysis of the market forces. And so this child was reading this like P5 or P6 at the time she was. And of course she can read, but she does not understand a word of what she's reading. So that means sometimes she can, and then goes on. And it's obviously you see that she doesn't understand. You as a reader, so for me, it was to express the sense of alienation, and then I had the string quartet, and the musically the string quartet was actually also a bit the same idea. It starts, it grows, and then there is a bubble, it explodes, and then it recedes. And that one was not exactly finishing on a positive mood, so. That was an interesting piece, and I had quite a few people from the financial sector who came to the concert and watched and listened. So actually everything can be a source of inspiration. But I don't think, I wouldn't say, because I've had composition students or I mentored sometimes. I often get friends who say, oh, why don't you write a piece on I don't know, they hear some noise in the kitchen, or they see a car passing, hey, you can do a piece on this. That's not enough. Because as you know, to write a piece is a lot of time, energy. And then after that is also a lot of time and energy resources to have it played. So it's not that simple. Of course, you can always come with something. The sound of the MRT or the handphone, and say, why don't you write the piece? Yeah, yeah, yeah. But so it's not that today I want to start writing a piece. What shall I write about? I look left and right in my flat or no. It's not like that. the answers to musical questions and the source of inspiration, I find them outside of music. It's not by listening to a symphony of Beethoven or a piece by Schoenberg or a piece by one of my colleagues in Singapore that suddenly I have an inspiration for a theme. But it's by talking to people who are not in music, by reading books that have nothing to do with music, that I find something that resonates inside. And at one point, sometimes I'm very struck by something, and then it just is somewhere in a drawer in the memory. And then one day when I want to write a piece, I say, oh yes, I want to do about that. And then start the work of research and well, how am I going to do? And for me, before knowing what I'm going to do in a piece, it invariably goes through the process of finding out what I'm not going to do. And so that's how I start to also to build a structure, to make some rules. I like to decide some rules. In this piece, there's not going to be don't know what. I decide a mode, and these three pitches are not in the mode. Well, I'm not going to use them, full stop. A few restrictions are very good to focus instead of you can do anything. But in the last period, I can spend hours on little details left and right, which for the general listener, frankly, wouldn't make a difference. But which make a difference for me in between a better piece, the best I can do at the moment. And I totally subscribe to what Shostakovich said. He said that the correction to my piece is the next piece. So I have worked the max I can on that piece, and that's it. That's what I can do with that piece. And the only corrections I make is after the premiere, all the small improvements done during the rehearsal process. And then that's it. I'm not going to, 1 year later, to make another version again of the same piece. Then it's unconsciously where I may have failed in this piece of today, I may address that again in another piece, completely different, and do it better because I learned from the previous. When I was young, I was actually wrong to think that I have to wait. I'm not ready. And wrong to compare myself with all these masterworks that I was really analyzing to conduct them. Wow, how they take this idea and make this and this, and then the total surprise there, and then what can I do? So it's wrong. And I tell this to young composers, you are so negative to yourself and you don't allow yourself to start the first step and a second step and to grow because you look at these mountains and think you never get anywhere that. Now, this is not to say that now I think I'm better than all these composers that I have named or equal. It's not at all that, but you do a journey, and composition is like a muscle. I really think you get better and you work faster and more efficient just because you do it one piece after another. You have to trust life and trust yourself, but work hard because it's people have no idea how hard it is, as in amount of work. And I think, surely listen to a lot of music, but listen in an active way to see how is the engine inside. But also really go and look outside of music. Because somewhere everything is connected. Somewhere, somehow, everything is connected.
So with that, one of my ending questions for you would be, having been in Singapore for over 25 years, actually more than 25 years, what are some of the things that you are really proud to have witnessed over the years, in terms of our progress as a country or in the music scene?
Music has a stronger and better and bigger place in society. Now, if a young person wants to go and study music, most of the parents will agree and help. You don't hear anymore these horror stories of actually wanted to do music, but I had to go and study medicine or become a lawyer. When I arrived, you had La Salle and Nafa, and then they were going through ups and downs, cyclical. So they are much more robust institutions nowadays. And Yong Shu To is fantastic to have a real conservatory of music. And many more Singaporeans go and study overseas. Now it's not anymore exceptional to have a doctorate. It becomes seems like everybody has a doctorate in music. And so the level of education is. Then also the facilities. You go in some secondary schools, it's like they have a concert hall. You go, wow, yeah. And then the whole Esplanade complex. NSC has also come a long way. To me, it has really improved a lot. No country where you have, let's say Germany or Austria, these musical cultures have not been built in a generation or two. It will take 100 years. On a more general level, I do, with a bit of nostalgia, I prefer Singapore before Marine Bay Sands and the casino and all that. I don't think it's, first of all, aesthetically very beautiful. And it has made, and all that money floating, whether it's clean money or dirty money, it makes, I have somewhere a feeling that Singapore is a bit sold its soul for money. And it's much more money obsessed than it used to be. So that's the only thing that I find less uplifting. But the performing arts facilities, the career possibilities, and the number of level of institutions, music institutions, and the quality of SSO, has come a long way. So that is positive, but it will take a long time. And then to all Singaporeans who tell me, but it's not Vienna Philharmonic, it's not Berlin, it's not New York Philharmonic, I say, no, but it's those organizations that you name, they have also they haven't reached the level they are after 40 years, 50 years. And that an artistic career is dicey. Yes, it's also in Germany and in the States and in England.
Yeah, I agree with you, definitely. It's really encouraging and just unbelievable that we have progressed so much as a country in such little time. And as you mentioned, culture, building culture and heritage really takes a lot of time, many years, or many decades even. So Before you go, I really want to ask if you have any word of advice for aspiring composers, especially young composers who may be school students now and just getting started in their composing journey.
It's one to, at the same time, avoid arrogance. I write something and I think is the greatest piece ever written, and I know it much better than the others, and I write against the instruments I did some summer courses with Peter Maxwell Davies, a British composer, and I remember that he said, if an idea is complex, if it's generally complex, the writing can be complex. But if not, all performers hate something that is actually very simple, but is written in a such impractical and complicated way that you have to rehearse a lot and you have to, and you get a poor result. And that's lack of craftsmanship and lack of technique on the part of the composer. So you must learn your craft and you must be humble and work and progress. But at the same time, you must trust yourself and trust life and not be daunted by all the masterpieces that already exist, all the mountains that are there. It's not to measure yourself against, and you shouldn't be discouraged, and you shouldn't self-censor yourself. But every time you write two bars to say, no, this is not, you always have to be the son or the daughter of somebody. And nobody, even if you think I make an aesthetic revolution and what was done before, I really hate it and I go against that, there is always a connection. You come after something and you will be there before something else. That's life. So you have to trust that you, because you are honest, you don't pretend and hide behind big words, and actually your music is nothing much. You come with a massive philosophical theories, and what comes out is a triad with an added six. But so you must be in touch with life and be very curious and absorb all kinds of things that come from left to right. And then, and because you have roots and you have a culture and you have a desire to create, that must be there inside, like a well, and it comes. And then you spend the time and the energy and you will do a journey and you will progress. It's not possible that you write this at 20 like you write at 30, 40, 50, 60, because in the meantime, so much has happened in your life, so much has happened around you, and also yourself, like starting a family, having a child is something unbelievable for everybody. And of course, it also changes the kind of music you write. Not that you write, my son was born. Wow, I write now a piece. Only then I know what is life, and then I can write a great piece. That's also nonsense. You just, at every stage of your life, you create something different, and you do a journey. And avoiding to churn out too many pieces, but also avoiding self-imposed long periods of silence because you think you are waiting for the Holy Ghost to come with a masterpiece. It doesn't work like that. But respect yourself if there is a period that you don't write anything. A few months is okay because still it progresses in the mind, and maybe there is something you need to solve, which is not how do I resolve this chord, is more fundamental. And so trust yourself and trust life. I really believe in that now. Trust yourself and trust life, and you do a journey and you will progress. And for a long time, you never look back. You always go. And it's interesting once in a while to step at the side of the road and turn back and look and say, oh yeah, I've done this, oh yeah, that. And then to see, oh yes, between that and that, there is a sort of thing, recurrent thing that comes back. I never decided at one point, I am going to do pieces about nature, one after the other. I like the proportions, architecture, the math of architecture. So I am going to do pieces that use this. So I'm going to move to Singapore because I want to do gamelan. So it's also, that's also important. You progress in life and you meet people and you are in situations and be curious and be absorb things, be open to absorb.
Thank you for attending this episode of Broadcast. If you enjoyed this interview, do remember to like this video, subscribe to our channel, and stay tuned for more episodes.